Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick coming to you from the state of North Carolina. I hope you guys are all doing all right. I just wanted to make an announcement that I've, by the grace of God, I'm scheduled to be in Nashville as a first, as far as I know, the first place to visit on this time that will be in the United States. And that will be on June the 13th and 14th. I will be in Nashville area. Now, other than that, I don't know yet. I don't know if I'll go on, maybe going on down to Dallas at that time or not. You know, and all points in between Arkansas and all those places. Not sure yet, brothers and sisters, but I just wanted to make that announcement. You know, for some reason, I mean, by the grace of God, there are areas where there's lots of people, you know, who want me to pray with them and visit with them and all that kind of stuff. Nashville is one of those areas. Dallas is another, of course. I've been there already several times, but every time I go, there's a lot of people that I haven't met yet who came to meet me, and praise God for that. Got to pray with them and talk to them and be a pastor to them. You know, I mean, that's my job from the Lord on YouTube, besides giving people words and all that, kind of the prophetic part of it. Words of wisdom, words of knowledge, and then, of course, to be like a pastor, you know, as a pastor to people. You know, and praise God, you know, brothers and sisters, that's the thing I noticed that frustrated me before when I went to... Well, I started out as an assistant pastor in a Baptist church, and there was like 100 people. And, you know, it was, so that was the pastor and then me as his assistant. So, you know, and even with that small of a church, he was still too busy lots of times to meet with people. But, you know, I loved it. I love meeting with people and praying with them and all that. I always have when I have time. Now, it is true that also every once in a while you get somebody that's, you know, that's you can't help. Let's put it that way. You know, 1% that you just can't help, brothers and sisters. And so there, you know, as a pastor, you have to know when you can help somebody and when you can't. As you know, because the time you spend with someone you can't help, you could have already helped some more people. So that's how you do. As I've mentioned many times in my videos, it's like triage in the medical field. I used to be a paramedic in the Army, and I worked in the emergency room for 4 or 5 years total. And you know, you always do the most good for the most people in the least amount of time. And so it's always that way, probably, in all lots of different professions and businesses that people do. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I praise God for the opportunity to be a pastor to people. I've been doing it through the internet, but then when I get to meet people in person and spend time with them and minister to them and counsel them or answer their questions and pray with them, it's a huge blessing, brothers and sisters. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, if you take a fish out of water, it flops around, you know, and it dies. But if you put a fish in water, you know, it takes off and it shows its talent. And so each of us have our water where, you know, where our calling is. And so I thank the Lord that by his grace, you know, my calling is to do the words of wisdom and words of knowledge and minister to people and counsel people, pray for people. I love it. You know, I have a friend, a brother who owns this, like a maintenance shop thing. I don't know exactly what you call it, but, he does a specialty maintenance for big rig, you know, tractor trailers, 18-wheelers type of stuff. And we were talking before, and one time he was saying to me, you know, what you're doing is, you know, he didn't see how I do it, the ministry that I do. And so, you know, like I told him, I mean, you know, I don't see how he does what he does, his business, you know, because that's, you know, it's not my thing to know how to do the maintenance thing that he does or the business things that he does. I could never do it because that's not my calling from God. That's not my heart. And just like each one of us, brothers and sisters, that's what I'm trying to say to you. Each of us have our water where we are, you know, the starfish or whatever, you know. And then there's the places where we're flopping around and floundering, you know. And so there's many people, when they contact me, that's probably the number one thing I deal with as a pastor. When people contact me, you know, they're flopping and floundering because they're in the, you know, not always true. Sometimes it's the enemy and whatnot. Or they're not experienced enough in that area. It's also true when, you know, you've got to get started and learn and train and things like that. But experience. But lots of times people are in the wrong place. Sometimes we're in the wrong place at the wrong time. Or we're in the right place at the wrong time. Or we're in the right, it's the right time, but in the wrong place, you know. So, you know, there's a place and a time and a season for all things. And we're not all called to do all things, brothers and sisters. You know, there's lots of people. That's what I would say, you know, from as a pastor, there's lots of people on YouTube making videos. God didn't call them to do it. And they don't, you know, they don't even know the Word of God at all. That's not even 10%. They get on there making all kinds of grandiose theological statements. You know, and that's the biggest problem with YouTube, and particularly the internet Christianity, you know, that I have to deal with as a pastor of God, is dealing with all the nonsense of people who are making grandiose theological statements. Number one, who are not called by God, they don't even know what they're talking about. You know, it's just like me going to the courthouse and getting up there, you know, and telling the judge what the law is. You know, I mean, that would be retarded. That would be crazy. That would be just like me going into the surgical suite at the hospital, even though I was a medic. So someone that, you know, went to church for 5 years. Okay, I was a paramedic in the Army. So I'm going to go in there and tell the neurosurgeon, the brain surgeon, you know, hey, excuse me, I read in a book when I was a paramedic about that you got to do this and that. I think you're doing it wrong. You know, push the doctor out of the way and take over. That's what it's like with people, you know, on you know, because of the internet, the downside to the internet, you know. So as I've said before, the good thing about the internet is anybody can get on the internet and make videos and stuff on YouTube. The bad part is anybody can get on the internet and make video use on YouTube. So there's two sides to that point that I'm making here. Number one, there are people who are making videos who absolutely have no idea what they're talking about. And instead of sticking with what they know, as an example, I mean, you know, I don't watch anybody's videos. I've watched one or two of Andy Firecharger's. Now, he gets on there. He's a truck driver. He gets on there and tells about he stopped at a truck stop. He prayed with somebody. He tells the things that he did for the Lord as a Christian. And, you know, in the context of his life and his life experience of this, you know, a regular guy who goes out and does these things for God, which we should all be doing. That is awesome. But now, when suppose he got on there and started making all these big theological statements and stuff, you know, about the Trinity or about the, you know, understanding of salvation or what the, you know, the theological term is sortology, you know, order of salvation. You know, it's so funny when people keep, you know, arguing and debating about once saved, always saved, or predestination, or Calvinism and all that stuff, and they don't even, you know, like I've said this before about end times teaching. If you don't know what the word eschatology means, you probably shouldn't be trying to call yourself a teacher and teaching about end times, because eschatology is a theological term for the end times. And so sortology is the big theological $5 word for, oh, with inflation, it's a $20 word. It's the big word for order of salvation. In other words, you know, a predestination, free will, once saved, always saved, versus you can lose your salvation, all of those things. So that's a clue. And so on the other side of that, as I'm just saying, people who are trying to teach and make grandiose statements that God didn't call them to, as I mentioned in a video the other day, we have to give an account to the Lord for what we say. The Bible tells us that if you're trying to teach, you have to answer to the Lord for what you teach. Number one. But the more important than that, brothers and sisters, more important than that, you know, this is why I don't have 75,000 subscribers like some people that are people pleasers. Because I speak the truth to you in love, brothers and sisters. And I always, by the grace of God, not be putting on and being fake with people just to get more viewers and things like that. Or even to build the orphanages. You know, I had someone on debating with theology with me. And I don't care if they will donate for the orphanages or not. I'm not going to, you know, kiss up to people and agree with them just because they may or may not, or they have donated to the orphanages. That has nothing to do with the teaching and preaching of the Word of God. The orphanage is a totally separate thing from the Word of God. So anyhow, the biggest problem on YouTube, as I'm about to say, that stomping on people's toes, as they say, or stepping on people's toes, to say it nicely, is that why are people listening to them? And when someone makes some statement, some wacky statement of theological grandioseness, people come, you know, running to me and saying, you know, Pastor Patrick, is this true? Is that true? Do not take any theological statements from anybody on YouTube unless you know for a fact they're an ordained minister. Now, if someone comes on YouTube and says, I had a dream and I think this is what it means, blah, 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 that's great. You know, but not making it like, you know, this is the deal. You know, thus says the Lord, you must speak in tongues 100 times before you can be raptured. Someone says that and they're not a theologian, they're not a preacher, then I would totally basically dismiss it right off the bat. I would, and at the most, I would go on the internet and use the Google, and I would research it. You can find, you know, articles written by theologians all over the internet. Of course, you can find anything on the internet. You can go on there and read the opinions of people. I don't know why I'm on this topic. Let me say this. When you are on the internet and you listen to people's opinions, now if you know theology, you will know when you hear someone talking, you say, oh, this person is a Seventh-day Adventist because of what they're saying. Oh, this person is a Mormon. This person is a Jehovah's Witness. This person is a Baptist. This person is a Pentecostal. You know, you can hear from what they're saying. Someone's a Pentecostal oneness. Like if someone says, oh, I want, you need to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ to be saved. Now that person is probably a United Pentecostal or Apostolic Ministry, or there's a denomination, Apostolic Denomination, or United Pentecostal, Pentecostal Oneness. People that don't believe in the Trinity. They're a group that came out of Assemblies of God way back there in the beginning of the Pentecostal movement, probably about 1914, 1916, somewhere near 1918. They came along, and that's what they teach. So if you hear someone preaching, you got to be in baptized in the name of Jesus to be saved, based off Acts 2:38, and you must, be baptized in the Holy Spirit to be saved. That's what that denomination believes, and that's what it comes from. They're an offshoot or a non-orthodox group that came out of Assemblies of God and broke off, And so they were considered, heretical by Assemblies of God because of their stance on the Trinity and that you had to be baptized in the name of Jesus only to be saved. Part of salvation is that ceremonial baptism. Well, that goes against lots of the basic theology and understanding the Word of God. We're not saved by works, even the work of being baptized. We're saved by grace through faith, not of our own, but a gift of God, not by the works that we might do. Not by works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians 2:8-9. So that's just an example, brothers and sisters. And I think I started this video, and then I cut it off. I can't remember what I said. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I think I'd mentioned that, and if I didn't, excuse me if I'm repeating myself. By the grace of God, we were able to, pay off $20,000 of the $60,000 debt that I took a personal debt to buy the third orphanage and get it rolling and get it funded and get bought a house and get it fixed up. Those of you who've been following my videos, so praise God. And I'm believing for the other $40,000, God will make a way. God can make it, fall out of the sky, whatever he wants to do. He can tell me, go dig under that tree, and then there's a bar of gold, whatever. God can do anything, brothers and sisters. I have total faith and confidence that God will provide. When I went and bought the orphanage, I knew God would provide. And I know that there are many of you who are praying in agreement with me. The Bible says that one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000. So three can put, 100,000? Four can put 1,000,000, of demons to flight, of the plans of the enemy to flight. So, I ask you guys to pray in agreement with me about this. As I mentioned, I'm going to be living in the place where I had the dream about the rapture. Does that mean that the rapture will happen while I'm in that place? Not necessarily, brothers and sisters, not necessarily. We can't take anybody's dreams or visions outside the Bible as being equal to the Bible. I say that all the time. And lots of times people have dreams and visions, and then there are people that's had dreams and visions, including myself, words from the Lord that came to pass. That's true. But we see through a glass darkly, brothers and sisters. Don't forget that. Sometimes things are symbolic, like I can dream that I'm in my house. I'm in the house, but in reality it's, the Father's house, or in church. You could dream you're in a mall, and then it's like that represents the whole kingdom of Christianity, the earthly kingdom of the church, as an example. Things like that. So, things aren't literal in a dream. Most of the time, things in a dream are not literal. That's why older people, it says in the Bible, your young men will have vision and your old men will dream dreams. It's usually true because dreams are more complicated. They're more metaphoric. Visions are usually more literal. But that's not always true. But generally speaking, the way the Lord operates by His Spirit. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been going on and on. I'm planning on making some more videos. And I just meant to come on here to say, hey, I'm going to be in Nashville the 13th and the 14th of June. Praise God. I'm planning on being in Seattle this summer by the grace of God. Lots of brothers and sisters who I promised I would come and pray with them, and they have, situations. And I thank God that, that the Lord would let me be their pastor. It's a huge blessing and a privilege. to be a pastor to those people who would let me be their pastor and pray for them and counsel them and all that. It's a huge blessing, brothers and sisters. I don't see it as a responsibility or anything at all like that, or, you know, a burden or anything. I see it as a huge blessing. And as I said earlier in this video, every once in a while you get somebody that's off the deep end, you know, and that's the people that I'm not afraid, you know, and you know, that's why I'm not in for a popularity contest. I'm not afraid to confront people, you know, if they're getting wacky. I'm not afraid to deal with them. And I thank God, you know, if you are a shepherd of the sheep, a under shepherd to the Lord, you know, what's the job of a shepherd but to stave off the lions and the bears and the wolves? And in this case, you know, lots of times people who make videos, unauthorized videos from God, they obsess about talking about wolves and debating doctrine, and they themselves are not even called by God to even, you know, to get into doctrines other than themselves, but to go out and proclaim, hey, this doctrine is right, that one's not right, for everybody. That's a whole other ballgame where people have self-appointed themselves so much on YouTube. It's really sad. And it's really even more sad as people that will believe it, as I'm saying in this video, my focus of this video. But brothers and sisters, we have to first get ourselves personally right with the Lord and focus on our own personal relationship with the Lord. And I thank God, brothers and sisters, that by the grace of God, I have the opportunity to minister to many of you guys. And, you know, I really, as I said, that's my water that I'm in. That's my place to be, and I thank God for it. It's a huge blessing and a huge honor that God would let me serve Him. And, you know, in whatever capacity the Lord would let you serve Him, you know, the more you, I'll say this, God, the Bible says God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. The more you humble yourselves and see it, a lot of times too, let's see what the Lord is wanting me to say here, because I was just going to make a quick video about coming to Nashville, but you know how I am. I would say this, just like Elijah, when he went, after he called down fire from heaven and had the prophets of Baal killed, and then when Jezebel said she was going to kill him, he ran in fear and hid. And he was crying out to God saying, well, you know, God, I'm the only one that's a follower of yours. And, you know, I'm the only one, and I'm just going to kill myself. He was laying under a juniper tree. And God said, hey, I've got 5,000 other men that have not bowed the knee to the false idol God Baal. So in America, you usually say Baal, but it's Baal. This, that's the way it's supposed to be pronounced. Hey, I guess, hey, I'm becoming like the sacred namers. You got to say it a certain way. If you don't say it a certain way, you know, you won't be raptured. I'm just joking. I did make sure I give that disclaimer. There are some people who believe everything they hear. When, you know, when I was a kid, my dad used to say, believe nothing that you hear and half of what you see. And I think that's a good guide. but anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, you're not alone. There are other people who love the Lord more, as much or more than you do. You don't know that. You don't know everybody. The Lord's got His people, you know, and He knows all of our hearts. He's coming to get us, brothers and sisters. What did Jesus say? John chapter 14. That's what I'm hearing from the Lord right now. John chapter 14, verse 1. Starting at verse 1, Jesus said to His disciples at the Last Supper, when He was about to leave them to depart out of this world, He said to them, in My Father's house are many mansions, or these other translations say dwelling places. In My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And there I go, you know, and if I go, I go to prepare a place for you, so that I may get you and bring you unto Myself, that there where I am you may be also. Therefore, or wherefore, in the King James, comfort one another with these words. And brothers and sisters, I think I just added that last line. I can't remember. I think I had that from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, talking about the rapture. If I did, I'm sorry. Because I haven't looked at the text lately. But the Lord is what I just quoted to you. Nobody's perfect, right, brothers and sisters? But the Lord. John chapter 14, starting at verse 1, the Lord said He's going to prepare a place for us. Where He is, we would also be. He would come and bring us unto Himself, brothers and sisters. So that's His promise to us. at the end of the tribulation, the Lord will return to earth and gather his elect from the four corners of heaven. That's the tribulation saints who have died, the church that's in heaven, the true bride, the people that the tribulation saints who get saved and are still on earth, the Old Testament people who are in heaven and all that. He said from the four corners of heaven. People love to quote that scripture where it says after these days, you know, even, you know, on the internet, there's a video, you know, after these days or whatever they call it, trying to say after the tribulation, trying to say that the rapture will be at the end of the tribulation. Jesus said, I will gather my elect from the four corners of heaven. That's even, you know, Jude says that the Lord will return with 10,000s of his saints. Quoted from Enoch, seventh from Adam. Quoted from the book of Enoch. Enoch prophesied, as the Bible says, Enoch was a preacher of righteousness. He prophesied that God, the Lord would return, the Son of Man would return with 10,000s of his saints. You know, in those days they didn't have the word million and all that. That we say today, that's why the King James will say 10,000 times 10,000 and all that. In the original text. The original text, it says that. Because they didn't have the word million and trillion and all that kind of stuff. You know, with numbers. Anyway, brothers and sisters, we are about to be taken up to meet our Lord in the air. And so we shall forever be with the Lord, brothers and sisters. That's the one that I also mentioned. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. So, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We will be with the Lord soon, brothers and sisters. He's coming for his bride. You need to take heart to that, brothers and sisters. Be encouraged in the fact, well, the Lord is telling me to say this. Be encouraged in the name of the Lord. Be encouraged in the name of the Lord. Okay, see how God will correct you? In the name of the Lord is Yeshua, which means, you know, God our Savior. El Yeshua. God my Savior, you know, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into him and they are saved. It's also a song, but it's a psalm. P-S-A-L-M. It's a psalm. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous, that's us, run into him and we are saved. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. The Lord knows how to deliver those that fear him. Hallelujah. He is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think. Praise God Almighty. Hallelujah for the pride of life. Let the pride, this, you know, the Lord is speaking to me now, and I praise God for that. Let the pride of life be in your rearview mirror. Let the pride of life be under your feet. And that's the word that the Lord wants you to hear. I've been doing all this talking and teaching, but the word, the Rhema word from the Lord is, let the pride of life be under your feet. Overcome the pride of life in Jesus' name. Don't be overcome with the pride of life, but overcome the pride of life with humility, for God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud, brothers and sisters. God bless you, brothers and sisters. You know that I love you. I appreciate all of you guys, all the people that I've been able to communicate with, dozens and dozens of people, I don't know how many people that I've got to meet, people that's donated for the orphanages and the feeding programs, and people that's donated, you know, for my travels. Some of you guys have donated for my travels. Let me, you know, borrow vehicles. I want to thank the Lord for each one of you that's ever helped me anyways. The Lord said in his word, anyone that gives a cup of water to a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. So praise God, brothers and sisters. I thank all you guys who have been a blessing to me. You know, and a lot of unchristian people, non-Christians that I've ran into in the States especially, have been mean. You know, the devil's people. The Philippines is not so bad, but in the States, brothers and sisters, it's really more evil people. In the Philippines, it's like everybody's, you know, ignorant. Most of the people are ignorant and blind of the gospel. You know, they know not what they do. But in the States, every time I come, brothers and sisters, I run into darkness. And I mean darkness, spiritual darkness, and wicked people who are go out of their way to be mean to me. They don't even know me, but I guess spiritually, you know, they discern that I'm a Christian, that I'm a preacher, because they go out of their way to be mean to me. All over the place in the States, brothers and sisters, I ran into that. And, you know, I just give it to the Lord. But it's also true, you know, what you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me, Jesus said. And so that's also true, brothers and sisters. When people have been evil to you, as Jesus says, you know, turn the other cheek and pray for those who spitefully use you, bless those who curse you and all that. Because the Bible says also in Romans that, you know, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I shall repay. So the Lord will repay, you know, wicked people. I was thinking about that today. I had some, a person in the management at this extended stay has been so wicked to me. I haven't done anything to them. They were being, and it's, you wouldn't believe it. That's a whole other story. Just being wicked to me. And, you know, it's, and that's why I just turned the other cheek and, you know, give it to the Lord. I didn't call the, you know, report them to the corporate office of extended stay. I just decided just to turn it over to the Lord. Pray for them because they're spitefully using me and being wicked toward me. So I give it to the Lord and I pray for them, their salvation. But I also know if they don't repent and they don't change, God will, the day will come when they will answer for that, brothers and sisters. Just like anybody else who doesn't repent. All of us, if we don't repent, we have to give, you know, when you repent, 1 John, I'm going on and on, but brothers and sisters, you know how I am. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. The blood of Jesus removes our sin. So when you go before the Lord, as if the sin never happened. You know, God, the Bible says God cast our sins into the sea of forgetfulness. As far as the east is from the west, so shall your sins be from you, that says there in Isaiah. You know, for the new covenant. Isaiah was prophesying about the New Testament. I just want to say this, though, brothers and sisters. On the other side of that, dealing with people who are involved with the greasy grace concept of living in sin. When John, 1 John, the Apostle John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, who wrote the, you know, John and Revelation and all that, he said in 1 John, when he said that, the letter is written to the church. He wasn't writing to non-believers. Of course, it's true when non-believers get saved, you know, same thing. But John said, if we confess our sins. You know, and in verse 7 of that same chapter, John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 1, he says, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in verse 9, he says, if we sin, if we, Christians, sin, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So when we sin, we need to confess it to the Lord. We need to repent. Once you're saved, doesn't mean you never have to repent again and all that. That's what the, when I mean greasy grace, I'm saying people who are making the grace of God greasy. You know, sometimes people can't understand, you know, concepts. It's God's grace is not greasy, but people have making up their own greasy grace. When I say greasy grace, I mean man-made license to sin grace that God didn't give us, that man made. We have grace, unmerited favor. What is grace for? Not to sin, but to be forgiven. God gives us grace to repent. If we repent, boom, he will pardon us. That's what the grace is about. Not a grace to go do what you want, but a grace that if you do what you want until you leave this world, or, you know, God will give you that opportunity to repent. Now, you know, I won't get into all this theology stuff, but there is such thing as a reprobate mind. People that have their heart seared, you know, their consciousness seared with a hot iron, the Bible says, in the King James. Like their heart becomes so hard and callous they cannot get saved. That's for non-believers or extreme backsliders, a point where someone would lose their salvation. It would become reprobate, the Bible calls it. In other words, like I have a relative who's an atheist who supposedly got saved when he was a kid. And I told him about this. I said, you're so in danger of being reprobate. And that's already been 10 years ago that I told him that. And he's like, well, if that happens, then yeah, well, then I'll just have to deal with it. No. And like I told him, when you become reprobate, you won't know it. I mean, that's the definition of being reprobate. You don't know that you're reprobate. Because if you knew you're reprobate, well, then you wouldn't be reprobate. If you knew that you were not right with God and you had a consciousness that you were needed to get right with God, and a fear of God and a fear of judgment and a desire to be with God, then you wouldn't be reprobate. Someone that says, that doesn't care, they don't know right from wrong, they don't care about right from wrong, they have no consciousness of guilt, of sin, of doing the right thing, then that is reprobate. And it doesn't happen to young people. It's happening, you know, people as you get older, say at least, you know, at least 30 or 40. It's probably the minimum age for someone to become reprobate. It means God has turned them over to the devil. You know, God has turned them over and God would not strive with them anymore. God would not try to save them. The Spirit of God has completely been so grieved that the Lord has turned from them and he will not deal with them anymore. That's what the definition of reprobate is. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I've covered lots of topics and done teaching in this video. You know, whenever I get all prayed up, when I'm in a place where I have privacy and I get all prayed up and fired up, then I usually do some preaching. You know, and preaching is when you get, you know, there's more emotional involved and conviction and all that. And that's why another reason why, you know, I don't have those tens and tens of thousands of viewers, because I'm preaching instead of just talking nicely like I'm doing this video, teaching, you know. There's different styles. There's teaching and preaching, and I normally preach, which lots of people nowadays, they can't endure it. As the Bible says, they cannot endure sound doctrine. So that's why, you know, they run to and fro for someone to tickle their ears. It's like a Joel Osteen syndrome, you know, and Brokeback Saddleback Mountain syndrome, like Rick Warren. But brothers and sisters, you know, I was in my mind last night. I should have looked up the comment. There was a brother who commented on one of my videos way back a couple months ago. And maybe he's watching this. He can comment again. He was talking about there's a woman who's the biggest woman evangelist on YouTube, and before she and some other women that keep showing their cleavage. And this brother was saying, you know, Brother Patrick, if you were on, if there was a YouTube and you were on there pre-1970, you would have the most subscribers, tens of thousands. You'd have a million. I think he even said you'd have a million subscribers pre-1970, especially in the South. South or southern part of the United States. But now, because we're in the end times and the church has fallen away so much and the church is so full of false doctrines and flesh, that, you know, women showing their cleavage and talking nonsense and false doctrine that there's no rapture and all this other stuff, and just being a personality, called a personality, like Joel Osteen, like, you know, Rick Warren and these guys, they're called a personality. There are people on YouTube who are called a personality. Obama is a cult of personality. Usually in politics, you'll see your liberal, communists, and even the national socialists, the Nazis. Hitler was a cult of personality. Obama is a cult of personality. It's not about his, you know, in this case, it's civilian doctrine. We call it policies, you know, how to make the economy better in the United States. People say, oh, you're a geek, you're a nerd, you're a policy wonk. You know, let's have a rock star president. So that's what they want, rock star preachers. You know, guys in their 50s calling themselves the youth pastor, wearing one of these shirts that's got the big embroidery cross on it, like a cowboy shirt with an embroidery cross, shirt tail out, wearing blue jeans and cowboy boots, you know, and his hair's moosed up. I mean, this dude is just cool, man. He's got him a goatee or whatever, and he's just so cool, man. He's just hip, man. You know, and they have the light show and the smoke and all that. Ooh. You know, that's what people want to show. And that's part of the end times, brothers and sisters, part of the end times. They people want to be entertained. Well, you know, that's the downfall of too much technology, too. You know, when I was a kid, it's not that long ago, but we only had the three channels, you know. And then people, like when my parents were kids, of course, they were just coming out with television and all that. You know, people were much less easily entertained because there wasn't all the media and all that, too. You know, now there's a on-demand. Even they have TiVo and all that kind of stuff. You know, people have everything at their fingertips. So people are just like, so specialty honest. You know, you got Fox News for those who want to be pro-war and not pro-American, but pro-corporatism, pro-military industrial complex. You got Fox News masking itself as patriotic. But they really, it's the military industrial complex. Go back and listen to President Eisenhower. And then, of course, the liberals, you know, MSNBC and all that, catering to the communist, socialist side, radicals in America. And of course, CNN is whatever. That's, well, you know, Anderson Cooper was a CIA agent. Go look it up. So a lot of these people. Well, what's his name? Al Sharpton was an FBI informant. So we find out they're all working. You know, they're all the same people. The military-industrial complex and their psychological operations, like Jade Helms. It is a psychological operation, brothers and sisters. The TSA is a psychological operation. Why am I getting into this now? I'm going off the rails here now. You know, that's what I need to do. I need to have and I've been talking about this. I mentioned it to Brother Sid, who's been receiving my mail while I was in the Philippines and does the website. That's another thing, brothers and sisters. They keep shaking us down for money on the website, saying that there's spam off our website, which is not. And we paid some fee to have it, you know, the spam removed, and then they keep trying to charge us. So we had to take down, you know, they took down the website. We left it down, brothers and sisters. And so I asked you to pray about that. Plan on making a brand new website now and doing by the grace of God, if I have time, do a radio show, a regular radio broadcast at least once a week. Like I said, I'd like to have a soundboard, you know. That's what I was telling Brother Sid. You know, I could have a soundboard where, you know, I can start playing the going off the rails on a crazy train. You know, somebody's, you know, even myself, you start going off on out too far on and on, that we can just play that theme music. It's like a little reminder to come back onto the rails, you know, get it back in the middle of the road. Isaiah 35, that's the highway of holiness. And it says there's a way, you know, in the middle of the road. That's the highway of holiness. It's not out on these extremes. But brothers and sisters, that's where we get all these fighting amongst churches and denominations and fighting and cults and all that comes out of this getting off in the ditches, getting off of the Isaiah 35 highway of holiness and getting out into the, you know, into the ditches, out onto the crazy train. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I hope you appreciate my ramblings, as some people do. Obviously, they watch it. But, you know, praise God, brothers and sisters. I love every one of you guys, and I appreciate all you guys who have prayed for me. And you know, there's some people who have given me words, which I never really had too many people give me words, and I praise the Lord for it. I do need to work off the list I have of words for people, and I have not forgotten. It's just by the unction of the Holy Spirit that I will do it. I want you guys to know that I'm praying for you. Everybody that asks me to pray for them, I pray for them, usually right immediately. And then specific cases that the Lord leads me to, keep praying for you. There are people that I pray for on a regular basis as the Lord leads me. You know, there's a brother Rick. He knows who I'm talking to, and the Lord leads me to keep praying for him all the time. I don't know why. You know, the Lord knows. He's just one. You know, there's others too. I just mentioned his one name because it's kind of a name that nobody knows who that is. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know that I love you guys and I appreciate you. And I thank you for watching my videos. And I thank you for the opportunity to minister to you. And I look forward to seeing you guys in Nashville, Seattle this year, Vancouver, Seattle and Portland, Dallas, of course, again, Texas area down in there, Dallas, San Antonio, Houston area too, by the grace of God. Trunk Monkey, by the grace of God, I'll see you down there. Travis, Brother Travis, and then, of course, in the Northeast, Chicago, too. You know, all those places I planned to go before, it just wasn't the timing of the Lord, but I believe by the grace of God, this is the season while I go to those places. This year, the Lord's going to open the door for me to go to all those places, brothers and sisters. I ask you to pray with me in agreement about that. And God bless all you guys. I just want to thank you. Thank you all for your friendship and brotherly and sisterly love in Christ. God bless you all.